And welcome everyone, both on YouTube and here on Zoom, for joining us today. It's Thursday evening. Thanks for making time for this. So how this sort of like a bit of pretext on how this meetup came to be is that like all three of us, like me, you know, Ashwin and Nabaran, we keep meeting each other across different meetups and, you know, different, you know, small scenarios of conferences and stuff. And we have this really good banter over, you know, like a cup of coffee and something. And a lot of valuable lessons are, you know, a lot of valuable concepts are discussed on those conversations. And we had this idea, we were discussing something like this, and we had decided that why don't we sort of formalize this? And why don't we make it easy for practitioners to reach out to contributors and, you know, like, reduce the barrier, make it seem like a very next door thing to be done, right? And Nabaran was gladly on board on probably my first pitch to him about doing this. And here we are, sort of. Just a bit of short intro about myself. I am Joy/Hashfire. I have been practicing DevOps across various organizations in Bangalore, namely, you know, ResearchPay, Zoomcar, Hotstar, to name a few. And I've been practicing on Kubernetes for the better part of the last 5 years. And that's why I keep, you know, running into contributors often when I, you know, face an issue and I try to help the community in my own possible way. And now to introduce my co-host, Ashwin. Ashwin has been a mentor to me for, again, like the last 3-4 years. I have worked with him across an organization, Zoomcar. And I think over and out to you, Ashwin, if you could just give us a brief intro about yourself.
Hey, everyone. Thanks for joining in. So I'm Ashwin. I'm a cruise maniac on the internet. I work as the infrastructure lead at Verloop. We make chatbots. So Kubernetes is something, as part of my infra game, something that we've been working with for quite a while. And well, welcome, Nabaran. So let's you know, instead of wasting any more time, give the floor to the man. And can you talk about yourself, or you know, say hi to everyone?
Yeah. So hi everyone. First of all, thanks to HasGeek and Zainab, Joy, Ashwin, to have actually thought about this and pulling it off. When Joy actually asked me about this, that, hey, we are trying to do something like this, I was like, we needed this for some time, and this is a nice initiative. And it was not a question to be answered, actually. It was an answer by itself that, yes, contributors would need to do this. There needs to be something done from both sides to bridge the gap. About myself, I work as an infrastructure engineer at Clarisites. I work out of Bangalore right now. And so there's a interesting bit of how I got to know Joy and Ashwin, but I guess I would delegate it to them later on.
So Nabaran's workplace, Clarisites, they used to organize this meetup pre-COVID, of course, called Failure Modes, where a bunch of us practitioners would basically gather together and discuss about how badly our systems fail, right? And we would basically share the worst nightmarish stories about infras that we had encountered and that we have personally lived through. And there was so much to learn about that. And I remember having a great post-meetup conversation.
This is how you glorify a therapy session.
It sort of was, and that's actually great. Like, we wouldn't imagine the number of ways, like, and we would, but really, it's so interesting to think about the number of ways we can burn down the infra in so many interesting possible ways, right? So, yeah, I mean, Nabaran and I then had a very, very nice conversation post-factor, you know, after the meetup, about how the Kubernetes community has grown in the last couple of years, what we can actually sort of do to bring it closer down to earth and make sure that, you know, the community people are more reachable, increase APAC representation, how do we get practitioners to also start contributing, you know, like we battle test Kubernetes day in, day out, but Somehow we do not, most of us do not leap into the contributor side of things. And we were discussing. And yeah, that is how, you know, this one of the seeds of, one of the seed ideas of what we are doing right now. And now, like, apart from that, like, let's talk about your experience, how long you have been practicing Kubernetes other than contributing.
So I have been practicing Kubernetes for around 2 years now, probably started during Kubernetes 1.10. We were just trying out one of the hosted providers and waiting if Kubernetes is the right solution to our workloads. So that started my journey of using Kubernetes. And I started contributing fairly recently compared to the community. I started around 1.5 years ago, starting with the Python client, but we'll again come to that later. Yeah.
You started out as a practitioner, but how did you, like, by what, how much time did it take you to grow into a contributor? Like, what is the...
You have to decide where do you start contributing and why do you start contributing, right? So being a Python engineer since the start of my career, I've been writing Python since the last 5 years probably now. And so that one piece I thought that I should contribute to because I am using it, the Kubernetes Python client, in a small project of ours. So that's where I started out that, hey, I saw some, why is this done this way? Can't it be done in a better way? So that's how a contributor's journey may start. So this is just my situation there. And after that, so Kubernetes community is very welcoming to anyone who is like forthcoming to say, hi, I want to take up some roles. So I started with the Release Team Shadow program and the contributor experience special interest group. Probably I'll go into a bit of detail later on in the session about the shadow programs and the various mentoring initiatives that we have.
I think we should have that hook on Chris. That how did you end up? How do you know Chris through? Because we talked about how we got to, you know, talk about big stuff. How, what did you and Chris talk about? How did you folks meet?
Chris, do you want to
go ahead? No, I mean, the floor is yours now, Varun, please.
No, go, Chris, go ahead, please.
No, you have to explain that.
So, bunch of things, right? But the common denominator turned out to be the a huge detailed conversation about which switches to use and which keycaps to use on the mechanical keyboards. And it turns out both of us wanted a sturdy mechanical keyboard to vent out frustrations. You know, so to speak.
Yeah.
Very much geek bonding going on there.
you want to go, you know what, why isn't kubectl deploying right? Like, what happened to my pods? Why is there a crash loop? And then you need a keyboard to vent that out. You can't do that on a MacBook Pro.
Very true. Very true.
In my case, a ThinkPad. Sorry for the plug. Yeah.
Get to the actual conversations. Let's get to the actual conversation, right? I mean, go ahead, Navarun. So let's talk about what are you currently up to with the Kubernetes ecosystem? As a contributor, where are your guns trained? What are you contributing into actively?
So depending on what action that I need to take, I have like several hats that I can wear at times. So in the last release cycle, I was the enhancements team lead. So this is basically a sub team of the Kubernetes release team itself. And this is a rolling team which goes on. And this release cycle, I am shadowing for the release lead itself. On top of that, I help in maintaining the Kubernetes Python client and help out contributor experience SIG in a few roles. Putting out more activities in the APAC region, or how do you think about increasing contributions in the APAC region? So, yeah, that's all I've been doing in the community.
I think there was one our priority submitted community question on that. You come from a long Python background, right, from your college days, right? Like, you've been part of the PyCon also, right? So what's the state of the Python client when you compare this to the Go client as of now?
So there are several client standards, bronze, silver, and gold. So right. depending on those tiers, you actually have to incorporate features. Right now, the Python client is in a state where you can do majority of the API calls, you can watch for resources. Mm-hmm. Right now, there is an active PR on someone is actually PR patching in support for port forwarding through the Python client. So the Python client is certainly a bit less feature, feature proof. Like it does not have many features as compared to the Go client, but we are constantly working on like increasing the coverage of features that you can do with the Go client.
Great. And I think the reason I ask this question is that a lot of current practitioners in DevOps, their familiarity with Python is, they have a strong familiarity with Python. And this question pops up in my multiple conversations is that, can I do the same level of coding on top of the Python client as someone can do on top of the Go client? Now, I'm a gopher myself, but I'm a converted gopher. I'm a newbie gopher. But yeah, it's good to know. Cool. I think, Navarun, give us a bit of idea of, you said you work for a sub part of the enhancements team called the release team, right? And just as an introduction to the other folks here who haven't looked into how the Kubernetes community is structured, there are multiple special interest groups and they each have their core responsibilities. So I think I'll yield the floor to Navarun here. Can you just walk us through how this whole community structured, because I think that's one of the very important points to get into the community to understand the topology, right?
So I'd like to share something to everyone. I guess I'm sharing right now.
Yes.
So go ahead. This is part of our Kubernetes new contributor workshop slides. This is what we explained to the new contributors. I just shamelessly took it from there to show here. So the whole project is divided into several kinds of groups, you can say. There is a thing called special interest groups. So special interest groups are a cluster of people who focus on a particular part of the project. So they take something and then focus on that. For example, if you see the diagram, you can see that there is SIG apps. So they focus on things like stateful sets, cron jobs. You have auto scaling special interest group who take care of the auto scalers. You have network who form a very crucial part of the pipeline, specifically the
CNI.
Yes, networking landscape. Yeah. Going forward, so there are instances where you need collaboration between the SIGs. So there is a thing called working group or right. work groups which actually is a cross SIG collaboration to achieve a certain project. So if you see in the diagram, you would see that there is KTS infra or there is work group LTS, long-term solution. So the community is actually trying really hard to achieve that goal of maintaining a specific release for a like longer period of time rather than what is the cadence right now. And on top of that, there are specific committees like code of conduct, product security, and steering who actually take some decisions, as in take part in resolving conflicts or look after the project's governance.
Right.
And lastly, there are user groups who are actually interested with gathering information from the community or users. For example, we have a big data user group. And
so that's a particular sort of deployments who cater to that. Okay, if you are doing ML on top of Kubernetes, it goes all right. Right, all sort of ML workloads are possible. It's possible to run them correctly, accurately on top of Kubernetes. So goes for big data. Then you have Kafka, Cassandra, etc. on those parts, right? So one question here, you mentioned the difference between SIGs and WGs. Now, I was fortunate last year to be a very, very small part of one of the SIGs, which was a very short-lived SIG, SIG doc security. We were helping with security documentation. We did not achieve much because one of the reasons was that the WG concept back then did not exist, right? And there was a lot of liaising to be done between the SIG security and the SIG docs, right? To different sort of organizations within organizations, to different teams. So how did this whole WG thing came about?
So I guess it's been there for some time. I think it predates even before me getting started contributing to the project. But these are basically ideas where, let's say, testing and release need to collaborate on something. Okay. Testing and release are specific special interest groups who actually focus on specific parts of the project. But then there may be something where you require collaborative efforts. Obviously, you can have a collaboration even without forming a working group. But when there are like long-standing work, let's say you need to manage the infrastructure of the Kubernetes domains, you have kts.io, you have several services running, you have code search, you have several other redirect services running. Those are all handled by the work groups.
Right.
So that's where the concept came in.
So Navarun, now that you know you've shown us an overview of the screen, this actually is going to end up confusing a lot of the people here, right? So what would be a few areas where you know new contributors would start heading out to? So is there a place, or is there a SIG or a working group where we say, you know what, easy entry, can we get in, lower barrier to being able to contribute? Do we have some data around that?
So we don't have metrics around it, as in like which is easy or which is not. But there are several mentoring programs being run by special interest groups or work groups or specific part of the project, which actually mentor folks into getting started into the project. So those are the best possible aspects where someone can join.
Great.
So can you name a few SIGs that would have mentorship? I mean, I think I can note that down and have that pass to folks that are listening, because in addition to the screen being recorded, it also makes sense to have links that people can look up to and directly start reading up.
Yeah.
So the most prominent one is, so there is a mentoring sub-project of the special interest group contributor experience. They have some initiatives inside themselves, like there are some community initiatives from their side, as well as if you see specific parts of the project where you can get some mentorship. Is one thing which comes to my mind readily is the Release Team Shadow program. So you don't need to know anything to go and contribute to the release team. You can just file for a shadow role. And so the only thing that you would need is intent and time. So you need to be really enthusiastic about contributing to the project and have time to do that. So these are all structured programs, but all I would say is like if you are a newbie and want to contribute to the project, it's very like you can just go into the SIG meetings or just say hi on Slack. Let's say you have a certain part. So I would give you a pretty neat example here. So when I started contributing to the Python client, there was no program as such to get started. There used to be a bi-weekly meeting. And I just hopped into the meeting and said that, hey, this is one field that I feel there can be an improvement. Can I own it? Can I own that patch? Nobody's told me no. I just went ahead, filed a patch. Then people, the reviewers, the approvers just came in and put in some reviews. So the cycle went on. Basically, a patch. When you file a patch, what goes on? And yes, that's how I like started with a particular project.
So on the matter of patch, I think we will come to the detailed part of how, as a new, first-time contributor, how do you go about grokking the process of contributing to Kubernetes? We will actually, to our audience, we will actually have a full section on that process where Navarun would be, you know, answering a very step-by-step question of how to go from being, an outsider to an independent contributor to an org member and so on and so forth. But let's get back to where some part of the community is, like, as I was talking, like, bunch of us here on the call also are practitioners. You know, I see some of my close friends, like Akash is here, a bunch of other people, Rahul is here. We are practitioners, DevOps practitioners, right? When we started similar early times, 1.1x, 2x, those times of Kubernetes, and initially things were sort of simple. Stateful set wasn't there, pet set was there, and so on and so forth, right? We had a couple of resources and kinds. As the community and the, you know, the ecosystem grew, however, we saw this in the growth of the CNCF landscape itself. We saw the complexity of operating Kubernetes itself sort of pile up, and so proportionately the complexity of contribution done, getting a patch done also, because initially it was just Qproxy for network and CNIs came in, right? Initially it was just simple stateful sets with volume mounts and CSI came in. So the layers of abstraction sort of just kept coming in. Do you think, Kubernetes solves a very, very complex problem and is a complex piece of software, but do you think for a new independent contributor, this inherently poses a barrier?
Yes, I would not deny there is no barrier or there is no there is no roadblock while contributing to Kubernetes. There are roadblocks, but you have to see it in taking the hats of both parts of the puzzle, right? So although having no barriers makes it really easy to contribute, but then having no barriers also increases the chance of spam. So if, let's say, I'll tell you of a situation where if there are random PRs on the project and they do nothing, maybe add a space or remove a space somewhere or add a new line, the CI would get triggered if there are no barriers. Right. And that would exhaust resources. But although there are ways to do it, it's not like everyone who files a PR needs to have someone act their change so as to run it in the CI. Once you become an organization member of the Kubernetes GitHub organization, then all of your PRs are basically, they're tested by default.
So I remember you mentioning this in a chat with me that initially it's an uphill task, but as you slightly grow into the role, it becomes easier. After the first few patches, it sort of plateaus down the difficulty, basically. Yeah. You do have to take the lead by yourself.
Yes. So one thing in the last point was the community is actually trying to make it seamless, the process of contribution for a first timer. And then coming on to your question, when does it become a downhill task? Because initially it is a bit harder to start.
Right.
I would say when you know the ecosystem well, when you know how things work, how does a review process work, then it becomes more easier. And then you can just go in and ask someone, whoever is assigned to the issue, that, hey, can you review this?
Right. So, I mean, a lot of other open source projects do this to a level of good first issue. Is there any plan? We know both that currently Kubernetes do not have the bandwidth to, to be honestly, mark, go through all the issues currently that are there and mark good first issues. But is there a plan on, in future release cycles and feature bugs that to, start marking issues as good first issues? Is there a conversation around this?
Hold.
Yeah.
To the question that Joy asked, is there a way you can have a good first issue on Kubernetes?
Very, very aptly asked, yeah.
Well,
is there a first issue? Because I would like to look at what's happening because my CNI is broken, which basically takes me down about 4 years of engineering and about 6-7 books to understand what Kubernetes does.
Well,
and I'm not even touched the code yet.
Then you have to look at the label itself, right? Good first issue. It's an adjective, right? So it's very qualitative. It also depends on who is actually seeing the issue. So let's say for someone who is setting up the Kubernetes project for the first time, even a trivial lint fix may be a good first issue. But for someone who has built Kubernetes from scratch, maybe you come in there, right, with the CNI issue. So let's say if you have any problem with any specific component, then you can probably build the software and actually see where the error comes up.
I know a couple of folks who are on this call right now who I have seen build Kubernetes from scratch, and the amount of resources and the number of hours it takes to compile is insane.
Ed, that was specifically the reason why I asked that question, because first becomes absolutely relative from where you're looking at it. And as far as Kubernetes, the technology scope is concerned, it becomes a very high pedestal to jump onto.
I think that is why it is also very, I know, like, as a community, we would ask for something like that, but for maintainers, it's also a very uphill and difficult task to actually figure out what to label as good first issue. While I know folks who have state key why this is not there, and this is actually a good and clear explanation through this conversation, that why Kubernetes, it's difficult to have a good first issue list on Kubernetes, because it's not a single piece of software, it's a whole stack, right? And it manages an insane amount of complexity, to be honest. So one of the things that you discussed is that for you personally, like getting to know the topology or getting to know the people around Kubernetes, the mentors, the contributors, you know, the maintainers of individual things, this helps a lot, right? What's your opinion on this? How much does, you know, knowing the maintainer ecosystem help?
So I would say it helps a lot. It's basically, if you see any open source project, right? What do you need to know when you contribute to a project? Any project, as a matter of fact, you need to know the code. I would not go that far. If you see, like, one part is the code base, the second part is the community who is actually maintaining the project.
Right.
So if you have an idea, so let's say, as Ashwin said, he wants to contribute to CNI, right? He wants to file in a patch to CNI. Now we need to know who actually owns CNI. Because without that, if you randomly ping people that, hey, can you review it? It's not possible, right? You need to know who actually owns the code. So there, the Kubernetes CI bot actually comes into a big role. So Kubernetes has something called owners and owners aliases. So if you file a patch to a particular, so if it sees that change set to particular codes and then matches to the owners files, and then assigns reviewers and approvers based on your patch. So in that sense, the bots help you. But then even after that, you have to keep in mind that if not everyone is free all the time, right? They bandwidth may be limited for someone. So if you see that there is probably less activity, you can go ahead and ping in the SIG. If someone else can come up and review your PR, then that's also good, right?
Right.
So that's how I think you should tackle it.
I think this is important, that if you are going behind a bug, if there is a bug or a patch that you, it's a feature, patch, bug, whatever, like, which is affecting your day-to-day operations, right? The onus is on the reporter to keep following up, because in any community, in any ecosystem, it's not possible for everyone to be online all the time across all time zones, right? And your time zone would not, you know, align up with the maintainer's time zone. So it's very, very important to follow up. And just to this end, like, I have some statistics from the Kubernetes repo itself, and this is common knowledge between, you know, all three of us, but the community should know about this, that what happens when you don't follow up, right? So as of now, Kubernetes has this CI system of closing down old issues, and it categorizes in three ways. First one is a stale issue. And currently we have seen 155 open stale issues and 984 closed, which means all the reporters of those around 1,000 plus issues have forgotten to follow up. And eventually the CI bot could not find any conversation and close the issue, right? And there is a significant number, way significant number, which has progressed to the next stage of staleness, which is rotten. Currently we have 108 open rotten issues and 6,148 closed issues which went rotten, which means which is a significant number if you think of the scale of Kubernetes and the number of bugs. If the reporters had followed up, so many of those could have gotten taken up, right? And the community actually tries in figuring this out, that which old issues to actually not close down by applying a flag called frozen, right? And we currently have 734 such frozen issues where reporters are not following up, but community maintainers have figured out that this should not be closed down because it's P1 priority and they keep this open. So we have 734 of that open and 291 which unfortunately, you know, got closed. So Navarun, you have something to add there, I guess, right?
Yes, so if you see, it's a big project and several parties own part of the code base. Parties here, I mean by SIGs or work groups or specific user groups don't own code, but it's SIGs mostly who own code. So if you see, there can be different kinds of issues, GitHub issues. So it can be a bug or it can be a product question, basically how to use Kubernetes. So there is a very good resource actually for this, discuss.kubernetes.io. I'll also put in the link. So that is basically a chat forum where anyone can actually put in their questions and get them answered by the community. So those kinds of questions are actually not supposed to be put into the upstream repo. Right. Upstream repo has, there also if, and there is one more caveat, like if people don't put in a correct label, as in which SIG does it belong to. So many of the SIGs actually do triage. They triage through the issues and see for themselves whether this issue is relevant to them or not. This may go like unnoticed if there is no correct label. So there are certain aspects.
It comes back to our older topic, is that to correctly even report an issue as a practitioner, I should know which component is owned by which SIG, so that when I file, I go through the right process and so to get it even noticed by the right set of people, right? The right set of maintainers. So, I'll yield the floor to Chris. I think he has a couple of questions that he would like to ask you.
Yeah, so Zainab, we had a few audience questions. You want to line them up so that Navarun can answer them and then we'll move on.
Yeah, absolutely. That would be great, actually.
Yeah. Actually, Sumant has a question. Sumant, why don't you unmute yourself, ask the question, and also introduce yourself.
Hey, can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay. Hi, I'm Sumant, and I'm a DevOps engineer, and I work at Qualcomm. My question was, coming to the history, I previously was working with PHP and Drupal. It's an open source CMS, and I used to do a lot of code contributions. In that, there are something called modules, wherein the core part is the CMS, and we used to contribute modules which are like extensions or something which adds the functionality. So it was pretty easy to, you know, develop or do the contributions. Then I shifted to Python and Kubernetes. Now what happens is, I mean, Kubernetes, most of the functionalities are inside Kubernetes, I guess. So when I tried to code, right, so I was asked to sign a license or something, whatever, with the CNCNF or Linux Foundation. So then I stalled over there because I'm not sure what does that mean, because the I don't understand what that mean, like whatever the code I contribute.
Sumant, just to answer, so we will actually have a full section later on, almost at the tail end of our conversation, where, as I said, Navarun will actually walk us through the entire process, which would mean what CLA is, how did it evolve, and we'll come to the licensing parts, what are other things as a new contributor you must do in order to contribute your first patch. You will walk us through that. So I think just wait up for a bit. I think that section will answer your questions, but if it does not, feel free to rephrase your question and ask it once again at the end of this. Is that okay?
Yeah, sure, no problem. Thank you.
Thanks, man. Thanks for hanging up. Zainab, do you have another question from community? Do you have anything else?
No, not really. But I thought Suman's question was quite useful.
We will have a whole section on that. We'll talk about the whole process of how this whole first patch actually happens, right? So yeah, Chris, I guess like over and out to you. You know, you have a couple of questions.
Navarun, the next question is, what are the different groups that
you know, contribute to Kubernetes? You have organizations, you have individual contributors, people that are employed specifically by the Kubernetes ecosystem, the project itself. Now, while we have that, we have students as well. But my question as a practitioner, right, is why do we not see a huge bunch of DevOps people who are the first level, highest order consumers of Kubernetes, not pushing back into the ecosystem, saying, you know what, here's a patch, take it.
So I'd actually generalize the question a bit. I would not say it's just the practitioners. It's about anyone. Like, I think the one of the better ways can be like, why doesn't anyone contribute to Kubernetes? Like, first thing I would say, like, right, what is your intent of contributing to Kubernetes? So there are like different kinds of people that actually contribute. Some people actually want to drive a product. Some people want to fix bugs that they have encountered while using Kubernetes. Some people just go by the open source philosophy and they want to create a better project at the overall scale. So I would say, like, while contributing, you should take into consideration, like, how much time does a person want to put into the project, and what is the intent of contributing. Then there is a, like, it is a specific thing, I would say, to any project who is like distributed worldwide. Kubernetes is a very big, very distributed, very highly distributed project. Contributors from all around the world are there. So there comes the problem of time zones, and time zones are hard and they can't be mitigated. So
the community. You have personally led one such distributed team in the past, right? In the last couple of months.
Yes. So there I need to give a very short context on what Joy is talking about. So since I told earlier that I led the Kubernetes enhancements team for Kubernetes 1.19. So we have shadows in the team, and the distribution was like that. We had two folks from India, including me. There was one person from Central European time, and there were two folks from the Pacific time. So the enhancements team actually worked very async. So one team, so basically it's like sun goes around, right? And then people wake up and they take care of the responsibilities.
No, it's so, basically SRE's 24/7 call center life.
Yes.
This is not sun going around. We never see the sun. It's
handing over of responsibilities on call.
My 8 hours are done. There you go. Now you're on.
Well, there are conferences these days where the conference is held while the sun is up. So, So time zones are hard, and that creates one of the big issues. But most of the processes in the Kubernetes ecosystem are going async. Even we are trying to reduce meetings as much as possible, and so there is a specific effort going on in the release team to make release team async, and there has been like lots of brainstorming done by amazing people to actually make things more better for people who can't be in the meetings where it's like night for them or not a suitable time for them.
Let us practitioners know if that actually ever works.
It's all there out in the open. Like, we have a mailing list. You can just go onto kubernetes-dev@googlegroups.com, if I am correct.
Yep.
I'm just
typing that down.
Yeah, don't take me on the names. It is kubernetes.io. I am very bad at remembering that. I just have it configured. So there,
let's,
most
let's
of the
pick that up after the. Yeah. We share the links on the AMA page after the call.
Yeah, right. most of these decisions are actually communicated there so that people are cognizant of what is happening around. So,
So I think you mentioned like that on the enhancements team, a lot of work is actually not coding, but more around communication, right? Which means triaging of issues and features, product management work, tracking progress of existing features, their graduation criteria, managing deadlines of the developers who have owned up to, you know, solving a particular issue, or a feature and then reach out to them and talk, like, are you done? Like, it's a constant feedback loop, right? But here is a question, right? Like, who decides on a grand level and a grand scheme of things, who decides or what decides is that a process that says, okay, this is how a feature is going to make the cut for a certain release, right? How do you arrive at the decision that what goes in for into a release and what does not?
So in the Kubernetes world, features are called KEPs or Kubernetes Enhancement Proposals. They're just similar to RFCs or Python Enhancement Proposals.
Right.
So there are two aspects to it. So any SIG who actually owns the code for that KEP actually decide whether they want to make it part of this release cycle or not. And the there is a sub team in the release team, which is the enhancements team, who actually validate all those requirements of graduation, whether the KEPs satisfy that graduation criteria. If they satisfy, we have no problem. So there are two parts to the puzzle here. One who actually implements the feature, the other team actually shepherds the whole process, basically coordinates for the whole team, for the whole project, what thing goes into the
So release. At this point, we've got a few more questions regarding the release engineering process at Kubernetes, right? And I'm just going to say that we'll park those questions because we'll have a dedicated AMA. We're going to do one more print in a lot more granular detail, a lot of tech where where we talk about and nosedive into how Kubernetes actually releases software. Right. So we'll park those questions for that. Now, coming back to our topic, right, our banter. All three of us, we've got a bunch of extensive experience working with startups, working, deploying Kubernetes in their high-speed ecosystems. And we also, a few minutes back, talked about how the intent is needed to be able to contribute into the ecosystem as a practitioner. Now, as an Indian startup, as the Indian startup ecosystem, should we be thinking about incentivizing contributions to FOSS? Kubernetes is one of the projects that you can talk of, because the moment you say Kubernetes, there are going to be other libraries underneath which then evolve into the bigger FOSS landscape.
Right.
Yes. So I would say, like, this answer is probably something which holds true for all projects and not just Kubernetes. So when you see at open source contributions and the motivating factor of like contributing to a specific project, what drives those factors? There has to be value addition on both sides of the puzzle. There has to be value addition on the project. There has to be value addition on whoever is contributing to the project. There has to be value addition on part of the organization who are actually driving the people who are contributing to the project. So there are several aspects to it. And I would say, like, if I have to give an example in the Kubernetes ecosystem. So let's say there are some kinds of resources called cron jobs, which basically schedule things. But cron jobs are in beta for some time
and
now.
And has been for some time now.
Issues.
So if you are an organization who use cron jobs very widely, why not just contribute back to the community? Make it a stable feature. If there is any, just talk to SIG apps and show up to the meetings and say that, hey, hi, I want to work ahead with this. Can someone say what? So go to the KEP. There is a KEP for cron jobs. So you go to the feature and then see what all is left and how does the graduation criteria pan out. That's all part of that motivation.
Yeah. In addition to the tech part, I know Navarun, you spoke about the what all the stakeholders of that patch gets out of it. But there is another aspect I would personally like to add, is that getting your team to contribute back to FOSS also sets the cultural tone of the organization and the team itself, and which invites a lot of great engineers back into your team. It's like birds of a feather flock together, right? So once you start incentivizing that sort of contribution, other contributors will be interested in joining you, or other people who would actually join your org so that they get an opportunity to learn, be mentored by an existing contributor through osmosis learning or any other means, direct mentoring, and slowly grow into that sort of a role, right? And that incentivizes a lot of young folks also to join such an organization.
And it's a win-win, right?
Yeah, and Nabran, actually, when you want to talk about how your org is currently doing the current same thing?
So we use a lot of open source projects. Right. Whenever we find something to patch, and if the patch is trivial and we see that, hey, we have the bandwidth. Since we are a startup, we usually, like most of the times, don't have the bandwidth to actually put in resources. But when we can, we do that. So we try to patch things up to the upstream. Just a small example of how things can go on.
No patch is, I guess, like big or small, as long as keep trying, it sets the whole cultural tonality that, hey, we tried. And I think it's also the bandwidth type of organization also, right? Like in initial days of a seeded startup or early stage startup, right? People are excited. It's a small team. Coordination is tight. And it's easy to, you know, pick up a patch and, you know, get it done. But then as a mid-tier org, your focus is on your own product and your own users and catering to their needs, bugs and features and everything, right? But again, as you grow into a much larger organization, a lot of those people who grew out inside that, you know, grew up in that particular org who become seniors, a lot of the bandwidth frees up because then now you have actually people who take up daily stuff, but you get the free bandwidth to contribute back on something that you have been using for the last 4 or 5 years, right? So it depends on the time and place of what stage that organization in also to incentivize, you know, contribution back.
So, On the topic of contributions, right? What is the process involved with contributing to Kubernetes? What is the give us a high level read on it. I mean, we don't have to dig into the nitty gritties like I mentioned a few minutes back. We'll have a much more detailed technical discussion with the release engineering process alone, right? So we'll sort of pick and choose later. Right now, what is the bird's eye view of stuff gets done at Kubernetes?
Okay, so I'll explain this with an example. So let's say Ashwin found a CNI bug, and let's say you found a bug in a component in any of the Kubernetes projects. So what you do is you fix that, you set up that project on your local machine, then you try to replicate the bug, then you fix the bug, then you write tests for it. Then comes one of the more important processes in the whole life cycle of a patch. When you file a pull request, there are certain criteria that you need to satisfy. So all of the Kubernetes code base is Apache 2.0 and is governed by, so any contribution is governed by the CNCF CLA. What it essentially means.
This was the question that was asked a few minutes back by Suman. Suman, yes. So this is the answer that you were expecting. Go ahead, Navarro.
So this is very legal document in a sense, but as Suman pointed out, that apprehensions about reading the whole document. But I would say to anyone out there in the world, before signing for anything, please read it. not just contributor licensing agreements, but anything in life where you want to sign something off. But what it basically says that you own the code, what you contributed, but you license the community to use it as well. And this is very standard across projects. You would see you have to sign the, I think it's called Google CLA for Golang. So you have to say that the code that you write is actually yours and yours own. You have not copied it from somewhere, or it's not plagiarized code. See, all those are legal integrities. So once you sign the CLA, there are certain other small parameters, like you need to have GitHub, you need to have 2FA on your GitHub account. These are just some security primitives that are enforced to ensure smooth functioning of the project. So once you file a patch, ideally your patch is tested against the test suit. But if you're not an org member, someone who is an org member needs to come in and put an OK to test label on the PR. So usually you just ping someone whom you know or in the SIG that owns the code that you're patching in. You just ping that, hey, this is a PR and I feel this is important. Can someone please OK to test this? Right. But once you become an org member, this requirement does not come. Any of your PRs are tested by default. So a small note on how to become an org member. Some people might find it a bit dreadful, but it's actually a beautiful process of ensuring that we don't encounter contributions which are spammy. So in order to contribute, in order to become a GitHub organization member of Kubernetes or any of the sub organizations like Kubernetes SIGS or Kubernetes Client, you need to show a bit of previous patch experience to the project. You need to file some patches to the project. You need to be involved with the project. And then what happens is when you are involved with the project, then people know you. People notice you. Then you can ask people who are reviewers already in the organization to actually sponsor your application to the GitHub organization, to the Kubernetes GitHub organization. So yes, that's
I think, as I said, like it's a meritocratic ladder, and that's true for an open source organization, that's true for a closed loop organization, anywhere you go, that you need to slowly build up to greater things. So it's like the reverse of the Spider-Man quote, right? That if you accept greater responsibilities, you'll be given great powers. Like it's like that's how you grow. And it's also the thing that contribution is always, I think, welcome, because contributors themselves are a very rare resource. Not everybody in the ecosystem contributes, and even though like Kubernetes has around 2.8k contributors and around 1.1k org members, at any point of time, given the complexity and scale of the project, they always need more. The community always needs more, and it's not only just tech folks, right? It's about outreach, it's about communication, product management. There are a lot of avenues, talks where people are walking towards, making this thing happen. And it's a very, very, it's a wide scenario of, and a wide set of roles in a way that you can contribute, I guess, right?
By the way, just a plug here. The number that you mentioned is just the people who have contributed to the code. There are a lot more avenues where people contribute, which may not be on GitHub. So people do outreach, people do presentations for the Kubernetes upstream, as a marketing for the Kubernetes upstream. So like they're doing great work. That actually spreads the word about the project.
Right.
And we can't really count their contributions anyway.
Right.
So kudos to those folks.
Kudos to and shout outs also, right? It's not only the folks who commit code that make a product happen, but it's also everyone around who actually take that product out into the world, curate it, talk to the users, everything, right? Community
and battle test it.
There are people who actually test the release candidates, and they do a very, very important work in the whole pipeline to actually see, even before a release, if there are any bugs.
Right. So on behalf of Sumant, right, I'm going to ask this question sort of because he asked a very valid question, right, about the CLAs and he also mentioned that he backed off when he saw that documentation and the terms and conditions and so on. So there are multiple people. There are going to be so many thousands more like Sumant out there who are going to be on the fence about, the joy. Yes. So am I, right? I asked you about the CNI issue. So we're all folks on the fence thinking about whether to go in, take the dive, start contributing, fight that initial battle. But we've not been able to make that jump. So what is going to be your pitch for folks like us?
I would say don't get scared. Just read the document. If I tell you that just go sign the document, that's a pretty wrong answer. If someone gives you that answer, don't listen to that person. Like, listen to someone who says that read legal documents. So you have to be clear with the organization that you belong to, that whether you can contribute in your free time or not, whether you can contribute as part of the day job or not. I think these are all superficial considerations, but these are necessary evil in a sense. Like you have to think about it. Like, since this is a product as well as an open source project, who is contributing? That also needs to be seen, right? So I would say, like Sumant also asked a question that Will you face any issues with your company's legal rules? I would suggest consult them. I can't comment about any specific company's legal rules. It's on every individual to actually verify that fact, whether they can contribute to open source.
Absolutely, absolutely. You should have a talk with your org before you say, yes, yeah. I'll sign. That is
yes.
For sure.
Yes, before even signing the CLA, just have a talk.
But I think there is a way to sign the CLA as an independent contributor, but also as through your organization itself. But the organization gets the credit for it on the DevStats dashboard, right?
Well, it's just an annotation.
Okay, right.
So every contribution is an annotation, like who contributed and what affiliation does the person belong to.
Right. So I think there is a great incentive for there for an organization also. I mean, we have seen how very large organizations have turned around into, and you know, like initial being on the fence for adoption of Kubernetes to being one of the major contributors and actual maintainers of bigger projects inside the whole CNCF ecosystem, right? I've seen that happen in the last decade or so.
Yep.
That's so
true.
That is so true. So now let's take it one step further, right? The US and European ecosystems, the DevOps ecosystems have Kubernetes contributor workshops. You've got KubeCon happening where these workshops are specifically held for people who want to contribute into the Kubernetes project. Is that something that you would be interested in, you know, jump-starting in India? Because I've seen that in the Eastern time zones in China. I've seen that in the Western time zones in Europe and US. But India doesn't seem to have something like that.
I'll give you a nice fact. So we have this Asia Pacific coordinators meeting every bi-weekly on Thursday, today itself. Today we had a meeting and there was an agenda point of can we do NCW for APAC, not just India. And you would be happy. We will have it sometime.
Awesome. Since, that's good to hear.
One plug here though is the content is already online. Anybody can actually go in and see previous sessions and actually get a feel of what is happening in the contributor workshop. That's the beauty of recording meetings and recording events, right? So even if you're not physically present, you can actually go ahead and view what was being done. So I would suggest anyone who is actually...
That's not from your org perspective, but as a friend, right? You know, if I try to pitch this idea to you, say that, hey, let's be all online, let's say 5-6 people together on a particular time of preference. And would you be willing to shepherd, you know, like a couple of people, mentor a couple of people, just, you know, kickstart this whole idea that, yes, there is a mentor next door, there is a maintainer next door, to whom, you know, like you can quickly reach out and, you know, bump up ideas or just reach out and say that, hey, I would like to contribute. I know you live right down the street. Can I just reach out to you? Can you mentor me? You know, to, you know.
As I said earlier, nobody will say no to you. And it holds true for me too. There are many folks who ask me like how to get started into contributing to XYZ. It's not just Kubernetes. Since I have had experience in the Python ecosystem too, people do ask me like, how do you get started into so and so project? Back in the days, I used to work for NumFocus for a small period of time, who basically handled the whole PyData stack, the scientific computing stack of Python. And nobody says no. Frankly, like if someone comes up and asks, hey, Navarun, can you show me how to set up Kubernetes/Kubernetes on my machine?
Right.
Why not? Why do I say no?
I think actually let's figure out a way. I think I will, we will all speak offline after this. Let's figure out a way that if we can actually make those workshops happen, right? You know, unfortunately COVID, I would have loved to have that in a real space, but then I don't think like that's a barrier for doing it, right? Like if you are interested, like, or if there are other people in the InDev channel who are interested, and yeah, a good plug about the InDev channel, I think for folks here joining is that Kubernetes have dedicated Slack channels for people who Indian users channel, Indian devs channel, where a lot of mentorship is just, a lot of mentors are just hanging around. And even if you lurk, I am a lurker, I know this, even if you lurk through osmosis, you learn a lot of things that actually go on behind the scenes, right? And that helps a lot just to be there on the Slack and hang out and understand people's banter, what they're going through, what are their plans, how they see the product, that helps a lot, I guess, to understand what's going on, right?
You know what? That's async, right? And then if you have some block of time, just hop into any of the meetings. Hop into any of the SIG meetings that you are very much interested in. You'll get a lot of context about what is happening. And one beautiful thing is many of the SIG meetings actually have a section for new contributor intro. So if someone is new, you can introduce yourself. There's a specific slot. These are just special provisions. You can anytime go ahead and say hi to anyone. It's a free information world.
So one last thing, I guess, like before we close this convo is that you want to talk about the 1.20, shadow program?
Oh, yes. So right now we are beginning the Kubernetes 1.20 release cycle. And as usual, we have a shadow program. The shadow applications are open until tomorrow, end of the day, Pacific time. So it's like Saturday morning for us, kind of.
Right.
I'll share the link in the comments to the form. Where you can just go ahead and look at the role handbooks about what role a release team has, and then whichever role you are interested in, just fill the form out. Just speak your mind out. That hey, I
know this personally because Navarun has put me up to this, and I've been like really scratching my head about, okay, do I fit in here or do I fit in there for the last 2 days?
Release team, but simple.
No.
You should go
that is what Navarun is very pertinent on one point. Read before you do. So he has given me enough documentation for like 2 days worth of reading. Apart from
I spent my homework on that.
So right. it's like there's a proverb, right? An apple a day keeps the doctor away. I would say reading the manual keeps doubts away.
Absolutely.
It was impromptu. Pardon.
I think. The set of questions that
bring our conversation to a close. I guess like I had one last amazing question that I thought of asking Navarun is that why do people hate YAML and Kubernetes is on YAML?
Well, you can write your manifest in JSON, by the way. But
come on,
don't comment JSON.
Cool. Dynam is saying we have a couple of community questions. Sorry. I just wanted to instigate a good flamer online about YAML versus JSON and how everyone, like the whole practitioner ecosystem is split on YAML. So, yeah.
As Rahul is saying, that's the best answer. Yeah.
Yeah. I should someday ask him to write in JSON.
But you know what? If you are into the infrastructure as a code paradigm, use Terraform. Yeah. But wrong answer. This was a wrong answers only answer.
There is Kulumi, which is insanely complicated. There is KSONNet, which got deprecated. Now DAL is coming up. So yeah, like we got options on DSLs, no matter. But it's always a battle going on there. How to template correctly?
Why do you need to template YAML? They're so beautiful.
Yeah, just make sure you have the one tab equal to two spaces configured in your editor. Dot editor config configure. That's all.
So if you don't template, what bad will happen? It would be staging.yaml, production.yaml, beta.yaml, alpha.yaml for the same resource. What's bad?
Let me get back to Akash's question. Akash, trying to unmute yourself and ask your question.
Yeah.
Yes, please. Akash, go ahead.
So it's a very noob question. So what exactly is the shadow program? Like I never heard of it. Like so.
First of all, great question, Akash. I want to elaborate it a bit more. So shadow program, just take it as an example of an apprentice program or an internship. So there are leads who actually take responsibility of a specific vertical, and then each lead selects a set of shadows for training them in order to be the next lead. And the shadows also take part into the day-to-day activities of the role itself. So I hope I'm able to express it clearly.
It's like a Jedi Master and Padawan system, right?
I don't know if it is Star Trek, Star Wars, or whatever, because I did not see anyone. People may kill me because of that.
There starts the war.
Cool. I think, do we have any more questions, Zaina, from the audience?
Yeah. Sumant has a few questions. Sumant, why don't you go ahead?
Sure.
Yeah, so my question was, thanks Paul for answering the question on SHADA program. But can you just elaborate more? Because when you said like they'll be doing like some tasks which late perform, right? So can you give an simple example which we can understand? I mean, what will we do? Like, for example, if we are into a SHADA program, for example, for particular SIG, I guess, right? So there will be, for example, there is a release SIG or something and I am shadowing the lead of SIG. Will I be releasing the latest Kubernetes version? I don't think so, right? I mean, what are the tasks which will be and what is the time commitment if we are doing a SHADA program?
Great question, by the way. That's like a very valid doubt. So all of that is actually documented in the handbooks, but I'd give you a brief primer. So the SHADA program, the roles of shadows vary by role which you are shadowing. Some roles may be more hands-on, some roles may be less hands-on, but the ultimate goal to be a shadow is to learn about what the lead does. If that involves doing something, I would say it's an added benefit. So to give you an example of the enhancements team, the shadows as well as the lead, they triage enhancements, ask the owners if they want to be part of this release cycle, they want to graduate the CAP for that release cycle. Sorry, it might be a bit jargonish, like lots of jargon here and there, but as I said, the handbooks actually pretty much define the work. But to give you a brief context on that, you will majorly do what the lead does, but the lead actually distributes work amongst the whole team.
So Paul, sorry to disturb. Did you do a SHADA program before?
Yes.
Can you share your experience?
How
did you enroll or whatever?
Yes. So before being the enhancements lead, I shadowed for the enhancements team for 2 cycles. We were 4 people, 4 shadows and 1 lead in each cycle. And we basically distributed the work, as I said, amongst all of us. So let's say if there are 200 outstanding enhancements right now for Kubernetes, we distributed amongst us into 40, 40, 40, 40, and then reached out to the owners. Hey, do you want to do you want to make it part of the release? Now, on learnings, I would say you learn a lot of communication skills. People who are shy may break that cocoon. And you also learn. So one important thing that I learned as part of the enhancements team was actually reading the feature proposals and then understanding why those features came into existence and what they're trying to achieve. So this gives a very big insight into the next release, even before the release happens. So you know what is actually coming into the next release. All those added perks, but it gives you a lot of knowledge into how a Kubernetes feature is structured.
Yeah, so how much time did you commit to the SHADA program? Like every week, how many hours were you logging?
I would say it depends on the role and also how much you want to get involved. There is no specific rule. There is no universal time which holds true for everyone. There is a minimum time which is denoted for shadows. Like you have to put in X amount of hours every week in order to fulfill your role. But again, nobody would say don't do if you do more. And it's also dependent on which role you are shadowing. If it's a release team shadow role, which part of the release is it? So enhancements is more front loaded. Most of the work is on the beginning part of the cycle and later part of the cycle. Since features are frozen, hey, we have this feature. There is not much to do.
Okay, so one last question.
One of the other things is that there is a website that is coming up with all of these docs which are currently there in a repo, they will be actually propagated to a particular website where it's much more visible and easily understandable. Right, Nambarun?
Yes, so a team is working on something called contributor website, Kubernetes contributor website, kubernetes.dev, which ultimately would hold information, like it's a universal guide for every contributor. Right. It's currently in progress and it was launched, I think, a few weeks back, I think 1 or 2 weeks back. But it has, it also right now has a lot of getting started to Kubernetes information. I would share all of the links to the HasGeek like page comments so that everyone can put in, like everyone can see their, see the links.
Right.
And on top of that, if anyone wants to contact me, feel free to do over email or Twitter, wherever.
Slack also works, I mean.
Yeah, Slack works.
For you on Slack, yeah.
Yeah, the Kubernetes Slack works.
So, yeah, so Suman, does that answer your questions?
Yeah, the last question was, why enhancement SIG for the shadow program? Why not other SIGs? What made you actually select that enhancement SIG?
So, enhancements is not a SIG. It's a sub-team of the release team. It's also a sub-project of the SIG architecture, but both are separate entities. So, enhancements team is actually a license for the enhancement sub-project. But again, all jargon. Enhancements interested me because of the learnings I'll get about the features that I'm actually using in my workplace. That's the short answer. Basically, curiosity. Curiosity drove me to contribute to the enhancements team.
I think this differs, like everyone's, like you said earlier, right? Everyone's domain differs and they have to figure out their own vice, right? Where they want to contribute, right? What is best suited for them? If that's a release for you, if it's CNI for quiz, if it is probably on the CI/CD part of, you know, because again, I'm a practitioner, does CI/CD, I would like to help with that, right? Maintaining the CI/CD infra itself in future, right? So we're going to figure out our pathway towards, you know, growing into those roads, right? So I think most six have a shadow program, right? As of now.
Most SIGs have some kind of mentoring initiatives. It may not call a shadow program. There are specific mentorship programs like the component standard work group has a mentorship program to bring up new contributors. I know that some people are doing specific mentorship which are like driving up people into a specific SIG where there is like dearth of bandwidth. So it differs. So shadow program is just a term. I would say you should look for mentoring or people who would actually review your code.
Right.
Or whatever effort you are doing. It's just not just code.